Can you imagine a tenured professor at a place like Harvard Medical running around the world saying, I'm going to sell you a pill that's a fountain of youth. You'll grow young. I've been faculty at Hopkins Medical, and I can tell you, it's extremely competitive. You need to be very, very strong in your science. So as you can see from the headlines and his own statements, Dr. Sinclair is clearly looking for a fountain of youth pill. As this headline subtitle says, he hasn't found it yet, but he's sure getting rich, famous, and having a blast while doing it. In fact, one of his failed companies, even though the company failed, netted him about $8 million. So again, he's doing well. And he admits, sure, I can get a little cheeky. I got it from my grandmother, Vera. She was the black sheep of the family, but she saved lives in World War II.
The one 10 years ago that we found, which got a lot of media attention, was from red wine. It's called resveratrol. And don't ask me to say that again. That's a hard word, resveratrol. And so resveratrol, as you probably heard, is in red wine. Now, the problem with that is that you'd need to drink about 100 glasses of red wine a day. No, I don't recommend that. Don't do that.
He appeared on Joe Rogan recently, and he made the statement, there's a Jewish blessing. May you live until 120. That's seen, obviously, as hyperbole, but I want to make that obsolete. Can we actually make it an expectation to live to 120? Now, let's go back and look at actually aging in and of itself. Talks about the term whack-a-mole medicine. When you look at medicine today, we've got cardiologists to look at heart disease, oncologists to look at cancer, neurologists to look at stroke. It's focused on one disease at a time. But the reality is, let's not take a specific disease and try to delay that targeted disease. Let's look at the underlying aging process. And there are aging processes that we can find that are very much associated with creation of all of these diseases, heart disease, cancer, lung disease, things that start happening in our 40s, 50s, 60s, and 70s. That's actually called juventude, depending on how you want to pronounce it. Dr. Sinclair didn't come up with that term. Walter Longo, a well-respected gerontology researcher, came up with that. Nir Barzilai, principal investigator of the TAME study, targeting aging with metformin. Let's deal with the underlying mechanisms of aging. And I use the term mechanisms in plural because there are 6 or 8 of them that are very important. Telomeres. As our telomeres get shorter, we age. Stem cell exhaustion. Cellular senescence. That's kind of a technical word. Think of it as zombie cells. Epigenetic alterations. And of course, mitochondrial dysfunction and genomic instability. He actually unseated the mitochondrial theory of aging. What do you mean unseated? For 70 years, the mitochondrial theory of aging, this concept that free radicals burns up the furnaces of our cell, the mitochondria, and results in our slow starvation as we age of their cells of energy, that's been the real key for aging. Now, all of these mechanisms are active, but again, the mitochondrial theory was by far the most important. He started talking about a thing called the information theory of aging, and he used the analogy of the demented concert pianist, where you go to a concert, the pianist starts off very well, and then occasionally starts missing a note, and then more notes, and then more notes, and then pretty soon it's just chaos. On a cellular basis, that's what's happening with us. But he's actually found a disease model, a group of people with a genetic disease called the Werner mutants. Their DNA is just madly unpacking like a vacuum-sealed bag of yarn that's been ripped open. In fact, when you look at these kids, they have greatly accelerated premature aging. He said, you know, there's a lot of things we call junk DNA or non-coding. In fact, 69% of our DNA we've known is non-coding. That's where he came up with a term, ERC loop, the senescent cells or zombie cells. Since then, Mayo researchers have removed these in mice, and the mice live 30% longer. The Mayo folks have taken his discovery and developed a thing called spry cell. Quercetin simply from vegetables, onions, wine, green tea. You may remember the term quercetin because in the COVID-19, it's become a big deal in terms of being an onophore, something that helps get zinc across the cell membrane with the perception that it's going to decrease infection from SARS-CoV-2 or the coronavirus. Rapamycin. It was discovered in Rapa Nui, Easter Islands. You know that. That's with the guys, these statues, which has created a lot of attention. In fact, there's another fellow. His name is David Sabatini. Because of his work with rapamycin, mTOR, autophagy, auto meaning the self, and phagy is meaning to eat. It's basically where our own cells are using a mechanism to recycle. In this case, in this diagram from the New England Journal, you see this green damaged mitochondria, which is being digested and used for materials and energy. In fact, it turns out that if we don't have that autophagy going on quite a bit, that causes us to die early. Now, that's not something that's totally new. Walter Longo has been doing work with that, getting a lot of acclaim with the longevity diet and ProLon, fasting mimicking diet. And we've known for quite a while, fasting is a big deal in terms of prolonging life. And two of the big guys studying the genetics of aging were, yes, Walter Longo and David Sinclair. When you look at it, it's surprising the overlap that we as humans have with our genetics of aging and a bunch of other animals that you would think are totally unrelated, ranging from yeast to worms to flies to rabbits and mice. In fact, there was a professor a couple of decades ago, and he created thousands of mutant yeasts. One of them was a yeast called Saccharomyces cerevisiae. He changed that genetically to where that there was a significant change in aging. Dr. Sinclair, when he came to Boston from the University of New South Wales, studied at Harvard and MIT, he got this yeast from Dr. Mortimer and started doing a lot of research on it. It's a form of baker's yeast. If you starve that yeast, it doubles its lifespan. If you give a lot of sugar to that yeast, it ages early and dies. It activates genes in the RAS area and PKA, and it inactivates antioxidant functions. So again, that's where a lot of that basic work was discovered for these ERC loops. We've gotten more information from studying a disease model, Werner mutants. There's a lot of other things to learn and think about, and a lot of other science that he's contributed to. For example, he's brought back mice from blindness to being able to see using epigenetics. Here's the question. How can somebody that's a tenured Harvard faculty run around the world saying, I want to sell you a Fountain of the Youth pill, make $8 million on failed companies, and still stay there at Harvard? Well, maybe it's because he's tenured. Maybe they can't fire him. I don't think so. I think it's because he's creating really, really good science. So I think it's good science. He's just got sort of a snake oil presentation, and I'm okay with that. A lot of other people are too. Thank you for your interest.